good morning and welcome to this session on Beyond Austerity. My name is Domenico Lombardi and I'm from CG. And I'm going to moderate this session on default, debt, restructuring, or recovery. So just as a way of introduction, I'm not going to waste too much time on this. But for those of you who have gone through the IMF's latest wheel of projections that were released really a few days ago, I mean, what you see in the Eurozone is really a combination of low growth, especially in some southern economies, very low inflation, and high public debt stocks. And of course, the combination of all these elements may interact in a very dangerous way. If you take the case of Italy, for instance, where this issue of low growth is quite prominent, we at CG have estimated, Samantha Santamand and myself have estimated that assuming zero inflation, Italy's debt to GDP ratio in 4 years is going to be approximately on the same levels as it stands now, which is about 133% of GDP, the second highest in the Eurozone. So it's not for lack of try that it is so high. When Italy started the fiscal consolidation in 2011, the debt to GDP ratio was 120. Then they tried to bring it down the budget balance by about 2 percentage points, slightly more than that. And by bringing down those 2.5 percentage points, given the negative spillovers on growth, the debt to GDP ratio has increased by more than 12 percentage points. So this is just to say that there are a lot of issues, and I'm sure that the panelists will delve into that quite effectively. In terms of debt restructuring, I think really the overarching question is, clearly no nation, no country wants to join a club of countries that has to go through that restructuring. That's very clear. However, what would be important maybe to highlight in this discussion is what is the optimal policy framework in connection with that restructuring? Should it come early enough, or should it come at the very end when it's clear that no other feasible option is available? And what are the other reforms that should be implemented in order to reap the greatest benefit, if any, from that restructuring? So without further ado, let me call on Karl Aiginger. He's the director of the Vienna Institute of Economic Research. And all of you, we have 15 minutes, please no more, given that we don't have much time.
We have smaller losses of world market shares in the United States. larger manufacturing sectors in the US, and the euro is stronger than it starts. But after the crisis, we have 5 years without growth, unemployment rising, and we have to pay for smaller public deficits, higher interest rates than the United States, UK, and Japan. And we have the North-South divide about which our chairman spoke already. Restarting growth has, for me, five rather conventional preconditions. Stability of the financial sector, very much a topic of this conference. Reducing disequilibria, there's a policy brief we have written how to do this to restart growth in Southern Europe. Boosting aggregate demand, somebody has to spend. It cannot be exports only. If government is retrenching, it has to be investment or consumption, which leads us to the determinants of investment and consumption. On the supply side, innovation, education, entrepreneurship. We have heard today about the number of venture capital companies and the entrepreneurs we would need in Europe in compared to the United States. And we will need enlargement and openness to our neighbors and to the world. And now I come to less conventional sources of restarting dynamics. These are specific tax revenues. Reducing tax evasion is revenue source number one. Tax evasion is very, very large in Europe. Tax fraud, tax evasion, profit shifting. Income are shifted to low tax in countries, to tax savings. Profits are shifted to the countries in lowest taxes and service support. And we need to tax financial transactions. I'm very curious how all the panels yesterday agreed that our financial system is not stable, that the financial system is growing too much, that there's too much speculation, and too less investment in the real sector, but nobody advocated a financial and transaction tax. A financial sector can serve the real economy, but it has not to be necessarily larger than manufacturing, as it is in the United Kingdom. And if the financial sector have 90% of its transactions with other firms in the financial sectors, that's not really the purpose of the financial sectors in serving the real economy. And we could have more ecological taxes, this would save subsidies, and of course more transparency, less booking. So there's specific tax revenues which we do not use, and then we use other ones which are burdens to the real economy. Unused sources of demand, increasing income, specifically low income. The changing of income distribution to the highest income is reducing consumption. The lower 50% of our economies have no real wage increases over the last 10 years in the United States, over the last 40 years, but that doesn't help. We could boost consumption just by shifting incomes. We could boost investment into intangibles by higher standards, environmental standards, health standards, labor standards. We can direct innovation, we have heard in the last days here, and innovation is partly influenced to a large extent by government, as Mariana has told. It's not necessary to use fossil energy for houses and for offices anymore. It was forbidden in Denmark from 1916 on to use any fuel, fossil energy for housing, and I think that's a good model. And we can use the additional incomes, for example, the taxes I've called on in my last class for reducing taxes on labor. This would also restart specifically on low wage labor. This would again boost employment. Taxing labor is no growth strategy. If firms are net savers, this is no growth strategy. No standards for social ecological goals reduce demand and increase unemployment. Supply side, social and ecological innovation can boost growth, not only technical innovation, but also social and ecological innovation. New modes of production, digitalization, we've heard in the large sense of manufacturing. Entrepreneurship could be encouraged in schools. Enthusiasm and engagement of young people. Mobility, openness, migration, circular migration, people coming up from countries with high unemployment, returning and then creating firms, opening firms. Mutual learning across cultures, and more equality across incomes, gender, and education would boost economic growth also on the supply side. Resilience, positively, I am a fan of the financial sector, it has a positive role in economics, but financial transactions could be taxed. This reduces short-run speculative transactions, hopefully, but even if not, it's an income source which can be used to reduce taxes on labor and taxes on business, stimulating real economy. Taxes, except excessive profits, maybe getting rid of past debt, with other also on this battle we get. Euro bonds and Europe will allow Europe to have as low interest rates as those countries which have higher debt, which I have already. The new growth path should not be the old one. Principle of a new dynamics will be ecological sustainability, climate policy, reduce poverty and reduce unemployment, high incomes pay high taxes and don't shift profits, transparency, less corruption are growth drivers, fair taxes, smart government, not more regulation but smarter regulation is the goal. Choice is an openness and a mobility. We shouldn't have a government which decides about everything, but it has to be an open society with choices, with mobilities. Culture and diversity is a great chance for Europe, and we will probably need some sort of world governance because some of our problems are worldwide problems, starting from bankruptcy of governments to ecological problems. I think we have, there are two roads ahead for the United States and for Europe. A low growth path, competing by low wages, by low prices for energy, and a high growth path, climbing up the quality ladder, more education, innovation as growth drivers, providing capabilities in Professor Sen's sense, new industrial policy, convening coordination, risk pooling and reduction, risk pooling and risk reduction. Let us look at the MIT project by Susanne Berger, which addresses innovation gap in the United States. Considering societal goals and industrial strategy, equity is an issue, maybe the most pressing, besides with stabilizing of the financial sectors. And still, at this conference, it has will be said that distributional questions are important. I'm rather interesting whether there will be any conclusion how we could close the gap between the high incomes and the low incomes. Europe should not follow the lower labor costs, lower energy costs model, which is offered by some economists for the United States. And the United States are very proud now that they get clean, cheap energy in the future, but the problem with the United States is the increasing trade deficit in the technology sector and the decreasing income shares, world market shares in the technology sectors. And you don't solve the problem of deficits in the technology sector by providing cheaper energy to the energy intensive industries. These are quite different things. You see, Europe is not the world champion in this respect, but much better. There is a much larger share in exports of technology intensive products than the United States, and Europe's world market share is declining less in this respect. And that's the reason why the total world market share in Europe are declining less than those of the United States. Coming to the summary, we have what are the essential features of a European high growth model? Financial stability, including solving the debt burden, which we discussed soon by the other contributors, reducing unemployment and the income spread, absolute decoupling of material and fossil energy from economic growth, not lower elasticities, but plus 20% GDP, less 50 or 80% fossil energy is the goal. Restructuring of governments. Governments are very large. They account for 50% of European European economy, and the governments are very, very inefficient. They have a lot of bureaucracy, but they don't get the targets for which they intervene. More transparency and accountability, similar drivers of dynamics. Distribution matters, distribution income, wealth, gender, and age. Openness, capabilities, entrepreneurship, diversities, and choices at the side about welfare. Three mindset changes in economic thinking are necessary for Europe to get to this growth we have to change our target from GDP to broader goals, let us say beyond GDP goals, from growth as an objective to growth as an instrument or a result of a decentralized decision, from low prices as overarching goal for competitiveness to excellent capabilities as driver of the high road competitiveness, a dynamic, open, mobile society. And the one message for Europe is to stay competitive with the United States. Europe has to match US energy prices and stagnant median wages. Matching the US hype for shale gas sets limit for higher energy taxes, for higher standards for housing and transport, for the re-establishment of the emission trading, which broke down and increased the use of coal in Europe with progress energies. High wage countries beyond GDP strategies can never succeed with low energy prices. The scientific support, and this is why I said that it's based on scientific research, is a project WWW for Europe, which means Wealth and Work for Europe. The core of the project is to design a growth path for Europe which is more dynamic, more inclusive, and more sustainable. 33 institutions and universities are cooperating, was tendered by the European Commission, which we won, and we have used outsiders of the United States economic system from Kenneth Carroll to Jeffrey Sachs to support us in designing such a new growth path. The analytical part is necessity and feasibility of a new model, and 100 papers are available on our homepage up to now. The vision of this project is a growth model based on three pillars: dynamics, inclusion, and sustainability in a society with openness, trust, and resilience. That's a demanding project, since up to now we have no growth with an absolute decline in resource use, and up to now we have no growth model with full employment. We have to make these three pillars, income, social inclusion, ecological sustainability, compatible, and joining the forces between WW Europe and INET and CG would be a great success if we could do it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Karl, for staying within your allotted time. I'm going to go to Ulrich Hege, Professor of Finance at HEC School of Management.
Thank you. Start of the European debt crisis in 2009, the Eurozone found itself fighting an increasing desperate battle against the fall of one of its members with the successive rescues of Greece, Ireland, Portugal, Spain, and Cyprus. In early summer 2012, the situation looked pretty bleak, like the Eurozone embattled, you know, not being able to fight the bond markets, taking out one member after the others, spreads rising, and even key members like France and Italy being in this increasingly precarious situation. And then a miracle occurred. The seas suddenly calmed. With the words of one man, the European Central Bank's Mario Draghi, who said the ECB would do whatever it takes to save the euro. It's worth recalling that timeline to illustrate to what extent the Eurozone currently is almost exclusively pinning all its hopes on a monetary relief mechanism. So far, it seems to be working. Bond yields are at levels not seen since 2010. Portuguese yields are below 4%, even Greece is borrowing again. However, all is not well. The average debt to GDP ratio in the Eurozone has gone up by 3% since 2012, and there are worries about deflation. That's a bit surprising. Might easily pricing, if we look at the theory of debt overhang. As a professor of finance, I will start here, so that's my theory slide. It would be nice if our European policymakers would look a little bit more to the insights by some very powerful economic theories. Debt overhang, as we teach it to our students, not only applies to corporates, but also to sovereigns. A government scrambling to create a primary surplus to service its debt is cutting down spending, increasing its taxes. Future tax increases are anticipated. That impacts not only the government's decision, but also those of private decision makers. Companies will cut back investment, FDI inflows will dry up, and people will emigrate. That's all effects of debt overhang, and they are compounded by something just as bad, debt deflation, as first formulated by Ulrich Fischer in 1933. That means as parties try to save in order to reduce their debt burden, they are having a negative impact on demand that puts pressure on prices, produces deflation, and the deflation actually will bring up the real value of debt rather than bringing it down. So it's a prisoner's dilemma. Everyone tries to reduce its debt, and we end up in a situation because of debt deflation that the real value of debt is actually going up. We have seen this played out over the last 20 years in a very powerful way, illustrated in Japan. There has also been called the balance sheet recession. Initially, corporates saving up, that produced a recession, the government stepping in to try to stimulate the economy, with the result that we know, record debt to GDP ratios of 230%. Since Europe is pinning so much of its hopes on a monetary rescue, it's like the Titanic, you're trying to forget the danger in Europe, it's worthwhile pointing out that, you know, on the basis of principles, there are serious disadvantages of trying to look for rescue there rather than the obvious alternative, which is debt restructuring. By debt restructuring, for this talk, I mean orderly default, you know, either with the default procedure or a, you know, agreement with the creditors. First, easy monetary policy should reduce inflation. It doesn't currently, but that's what it should do, and therefore provide debt relief. However, it provides then debt relief to all debts, even including the non-distressed debts. Right? So that is a very, you know, inefficient tool. It's like a farmer spraying Roundup, killing all weeds rather than targeting the bad weeds. And by contrast, debt restructuring is, you know, just reducing the level of the debt. Second, it's an open secret that central banks, not only the ECB and the Bank of England in Europe, but also the Fed in the United States, would not mind inflation ticking up a little bit to say something like 3%. The trouble is they are not getting there in spite of quantitative easing and all that. Right? It's a very imprecise, precise science. As much as central banks are good at manipulating interest rates, they are not nearly as good in targeting inflation. And once they will get there, chances are actually inflation will tick up much more than they want, and so on. By contrast, that restructuring is actually can precisely fine-tune the level of debt relief you want. Third, when the European Central Bank in September 2012 announced the OMT, the Outright Monetary Transaction Program, that specifically targeted, you know, had the purpose of providing relief to distressed sovereigns, it said this will be a temporary stopgap. However, knowing the workings of European policy, you know, it would be temporary until the banking union, the fiscal union are in place. This will have to be a very long temporary stopgap. And, you know, here we are in uncharted waters. We don't know yet, in spite of financial markets currently being enamored by quantitative easing, we don't know whether it will work permanently or that whether there will at some point some sudden turnaround. By contrast, debt restructuring provides reliable permanent relief. With Notion, actually, one of the intriguing discussions in the Eurozone currently is trying things on a non-monetary way using the possibilities of the mutual debt guarantees that you can provide in the monetary union. Take the case of Greece. We had a debt restructuring in 2012, bringing down the debt by 40%, largest debt restructuring in history, to 157%. up now at 175%, unsustainable. It's an open secret that there will be another debt restructuring, rumored to start right after the European Parliament election in May. Now, since the debt is basically all held by other... basically other sovereigns, they hate the thought to write down their debt. So they bring up the idea, what about keeping the debt high and bringing down the interest rate to zero? We can do that with debt guarantees, right? You can sustain any debt if the interest rate is at zero. The trouble is, and here it helps going back to that overhang, that actually, you still have all the distortions from the debt overhang for public spending, private parties, companies, and so on. Well, cost of debt restructuring is known, if it's handled well, not to be that bad. Often, economic rebound can start within a year, even in Greece. The projection is for this year is moderate, but is growth. If it is not so costly to restructure debt, why then this huge resistance of the European policy elite against debt restructuring? Well, the reasons are political economy. European policymakers as well, know that acting according to spend now, tax later, is the vote winner. And they act according against debt restructuring. As long as everyone is in the illusion that debt will be serviced and feels wealthier than they really are, it's fine. Second, debt restructuring means a potentially huge wealth redistribution from debt investors to taxpayers. Now, the average investor in sovereign debt is slightly wealthier than the median taxpayer. And in Europe, we have our own version of the democracy for the 1%, as Edward Hughes called it. We capitalized the US democracy recently. So our policymakers, too, are always desperate, looking for campaign financing and potentially beholden to money interest. And third, the European banking lobbies are very powerful. And they're fighting against debt restructuring, not only on behalf of their wealthy clients, but also on their own behalf, because they have so much sovereign debt on their balance sheet. And you come to the end, the policy proposals that would be, that I labeled, entitled Decentralized Fiscal Responsibility. That means within the Eurozone, we have to go further to flesh out the de facto fiscal federalism that we have and develop the component that includes what happens if there is irresponsible behavior, if there is default. First, we should have debt restructuring for the sovereigns that are over indebted. That includes certainly those that are in the rescue operation currently, but probably also countries like Italy. Second, we need a sovereign debt code. Brett House will talk more about this. I would think it should also include a chapter on local government debt, following something like Chapter 9 in the United States. Countries like Spain, France, and Italy have all experimented over the last 20 years with fiscal decentralization. The outcome didn't come out well as far as the fiscal position is concerned. So we need oversight there and a chapter for local government debt. Third, all sovereign debt must be subject to this, can only be issued if subject to the sovereign code, to avoid problems with collective action clauses. Government debt needs to be more compartmentalized, not only in a country, but the umbrella of the central government, covering all of the debts within each of the sovereign nations. We should have default, not only default for local governments, but also for, say, social security institutions, and so on. Local governments need protection, financial protection, as much as consumers do. There's, research in Europe showing to what extent local governments are actually, really victims of unscrupulous investment banks selling products like toxic loans. So I would exempt from that proposal central governments to sort of like not encroach on the sovereignty of the central governments, but certainly a public debt authority would be welcome. Banks should not hold, the second to last proposal, should not hold more sovereign debt on their balance sheets than what they need to, you know, to actually the liquidity function. For whatever reasons, government that is still considered as the safe assets, they're holding base beyond that, they should also be obliged to put proper risk rights on it. And finally, the central bank should be, you know, not be able to come to the rescue of distressed sovereigns. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
In terms of foreign debt are those that are showing them in the slide. First, you have in early 1980s, 1982, with the Mexican decision to stop paying its foreign debt, that created a major havoc for many Latin American economies. That was a trigger for the debt crisis of Latin America in 1980s. At that time, Brazil went to the IMF for assistance. It went over and over with IMF throughout the next 12 years, didn't help structure that. The situation reached the climax in 1987, when Brazil declared its moratorium on its first debt, on its foreign debt. And at that time, the Brazilian government, represented by Minister Pereira, actually offered something that will later be constructed as the Brady Plan, as a package to securitize the loans of the 1970s, to transform them into bonds, and to give a haircut in this process. Because Brazil was first to propose that, and Brazil was actually not behaving or not attending to what financial markets or multilateral financial institutions wanted Brazil to do, Brazil was the last country to adhere to the Brady Plan. Only 12 years after the debt crisis, only 1994, Brazil finally implemented a renegotiation under the Brady Plan, which involved securitizing the loans of the 1970s and getting some haircut on part of the debt. And that was done together with the stabilization plan domestically that brought inflation down, and that helped also to reduce the cost of foreign debt. The next reference year is 2006, it's an election year. Lula was running for a re-election. At that time, the commodity boom was starting, pulled by Chinese growth, and Brazilian export was booming. There were a lot of improvement in terms of trade. And Brazil again was posed with the choice whether to do more fiscal contracting to reduce debt faster or to actually accelerate growth and improve income distribution. So the choice was to accelerate growth and improve income distribution. And as in a symbolic gesture, it ended all its debt with the IMF. It bought back all the Brady bonds and started accumulating foreign reserves. The picture for the ratio of foreign net foreign public debt to GDP is that one starting 1981 till last year. You see that in the beginning of the 1980s, the ratio of foreign debt to GDP showed up to 50%. That was a time when the federal government actually nationalized all foreign debt, especially debts that were held by state companies and private companies. And then it went into a roller coaster, which is explained mostly by the behavior of inflation. Because foreign debt was obviously indexed to the exchange rate, when inflation was reduced by the stabilization plan, it went down in terms of GDP. When inflation went accelerated again, it went up. The situation was only solved in 1994 with the Real Plan. There was a temporary reduction in foreign debt. Then in the 1990s, it went up again due to the East Asian and Russian crisis in the late 1990s and the Argentine and the very own Brazilian crisis in the early 2000s. And it peaked up in 2002. And since then, it has been going down. And in 2006, the Brazilian government became a net creditor in foreign currency. So if there's one conclusion for that, is that to avoid debt restructuring or debt problems in foreign currency, is the best solution is not to be a net debtor in foreign currency. If you accumulate enough foreign reserves, at least have more set in your policy. In Brazil, this choice is very costly because the government has to finance its international reserves by borrowing domestically. It has to pay high domestic real interest rates to have this kind of insurance against financial turbulence coming from the rest of the world. Now, domestic debt. In the 1980s and early 1990s, the dynamics of domestic debt were pretty much defined by the path of inflation. Given that most domestic debt was indexed either to the exchange rate or to inflation itself, whenever inflation accelerated, it pushed the value of debt higher than GDP. Inflation was so fast that debt was corrected faster than GDP. There was an attempt of restructuring forced savings in 1990 under President Karl, which was actually impeached 2 years after that, to reduce domestic debt by freezing all large deposits in the banks and actually paying sub-market interest rates on those banks. That didn't went down well. And since then, the Brazilian government, whatever the president is, has never attempted another debt restructuring on domestic debt. In 1994, the Real Plan actually improved the situation by lowering inflation without financial repression. Actually, at that time, the Brazilian government decided to pay a very high real interest rates to keep an exchange rate ankle and make help that would help reduce inflation. The main novelty in that area actually may be helpful for the European situation right now was regarding regional debt. In 1997, remember 1994, we had this stabilization plan that brought inflation down. For that to be sustainable, the government have to control public finances. The federal finances were actually under control, but in Brazil, at that time, the state finances were actually very loose. Every state government has had its own bank, and it could expand its debt just by increasing credit from its banks to the state government. So what was done at that time was an agreement with all the governments, 27 governments, that the central government will centralize, will refinance all state debt, will buy all state debt and issue bonds for that, in exchange for refinancing debt at a lower real interest rate. It was lower than what prevailed in the markets, which was very high in international standards. That was done in 3 years, from 1997 to 2000. In exchange of that, the regional government, the state governments also agreed to have their finances supervised by the federal government. Let's say the domestic version of the IMF. So since then, this is an agreement that goes for 30 years, until 2027. The state and municipal governments have to attend to some guidelines regarding what are their primary services, what's the share of payroll expenditures in terms of their net revenue. So there's a kind of fiscal, long-term fiscal adjustment that came in exchange for decentralization or nationalization of regional debt in 1997. And more recently, since 2006, to accumulate reserves, the Brazilian government has to issue domestic debt in the country, which creates a financial cost. It has to sterilize the exchange, the foreign exchange operations of the central bank. And that had maintained the domestic debt stable in terms of GDP. And since the crisis, the Brazilian government also did its own version of quantitative easing in the form of issuing debt to lend resources to these federal banks so that the federal banks will expand credit and fight the crisis, and also created another source of debt of that expansion. But even with that, the ratio of domestic debt to GDP has been pretty much stable since the mid-2000s, since 2006-2007. This is the figure, the ratio of net domestic debt to GDP. Again, before stabilization, it went up and down, basically following inflation. Whenever inflation accelerated, the ratio went up. It went up to 100% when Brazil almost had hyperinflation in the late 1990s. And then it went down when you had a stabilization plan. And you can see the effect of the force of the financial repression of the President Collor there in 1999, 1991, which pushed the ratio of domestic debt down for 2 years in a row. And then when inflation exploded again, it went up, the real plan solved the situation. And then you have a gradual increase from 1994 until 2000, which reflects the cost formal or informal to control inflation. So this is the side effect of very real high real interest rates domestically. It went up again to another round from 2003 to 2007 due to foreign exchange reserves accumulation, and since then has been stable despite all the need to do quantitative easing and to do and to keep the level of international reserves at a high level. Finally, given the European experience, there's much talk about now whether restructuring will be the ideal solution, but well, coming from an emerging and developing country, I think we should not rule out recovery, even though that may not be as important in Europe as it is in Brazil. And because the best way to solve this is actually to accelerate growth, and that obviously depends on how you can accelerate that or whether there is room for that. What the recent Brazilian experience shows is that in the last 10 years there was a boom in the terms of trade, and the Brazilian government took the opportunity to improve income distribution. Not only did that not only accelerate the growth, but actually reduced income inequality because the government decided to give back all the increase, almost all the increase in its revenues to the population in terms of income transfers. That was a major mark of the Lula administration. Just to be fine, conclude with illustration of that. The blue line is the tax and social contributions to the federal government in terms of GDP. It went from 17.9% of GDP, 1999, to 22.1% of GDP, an increase of 4.2 percentage points of GDP. The red line is, consists of the income transfers of the federal government to families, basically social security, social assistance, and unemployment insurance. It went up from 6.1 to 9.7. 86% of the net increase in the government tax revenues were channeled back to income transfers. And that's why, during the boom years, Brazil was able to combine growth acceleration with better income distribution. And that's why, even now, with a slow growth, Brazil is able to continue to reduce income inequality and keep a low unemployment rate. Whether or not that is sustainable is something to be seen. It's one topic of the debate of the presidential election in Brazil this year. And but I cannot say much on that because my 15 minutes are over. Thanks.
Let me first of all say how glad I am to be here and how much I thank the organizers who invited me to speak about that. Second, the happy to advise you. I'm an official of the Central Bank of Argentina, I've never before the program for quite some time. But of course, what I'm going to say here is my own personal opinion and shouldn't be construed as opinion of the Central Bank. And third, apologies. I used to work already with mammoth computers 50 years ago. I'm a total illiterate in PowerPoints. Maybe I'm against also. But, so that's my only single slide that would give support to some of the things I would say. As you see, one economist that's supposed to be the father of modern economics had a really very blunt idea about debt and what to do about it. Well, it's a well-known fact that cross-border capital flows go through cycles. Debates about debt restructuring also go through cycles, but they are counter-cyclical. It's good for us economists because it keeps us active when so many other citizens are unemployed. So the debate about that restructuring practically disappears in boom periods of cross-border capital flows, and then when there is a kind of tension and there's a bust or at least a decrease in cross-border capital flows, then the discussion reappears. And that's the case right now. There's a problem of Greece, there's a problem of some Caribbean countries, and there's also the litigation against Argentina for the way in which Argentina introduced this big debt restructuring back in 2005. All of those things have made up for a new debate about debt restructuring. So everything in Europe particularly is also very much dominated by the discussion about austerity. And that's why, in fact, if you get my paper at some point, I just changed the title of my paper, a little change on the title of the panel, because I say default, debt restructuring, or no recovery. The first, there are two points that I want to make that for me should inform the debate about debt restructuring, and they don't do enough, they take it into account enough. The first of it is an empirical thing, which is the question about what effect on growth or development do have capital inflows, the liberalization of capital account. Now, there's a growing literature that started maybe precisely at the time of the new boom in 2003 to 2008. Over those years, you can witness, although there were some in academia, there were also some people who had Joe Stiglitz, Dan Roderick, etc., had already pointed out to this. In this literature that, I mean, one of the first shots was a paper by Kenneth Rogoff and three other colleagues at the Research Department of the IMF, in which they candidly acknowledge that having surveyed about 40-odd papers on the effect of capital inflows on growth, they say that to their surprise, they couldn't find any effect, any positive effect. And this was followed by several other papers, quite a few of them coming out of the Research Department of the IMF. The most blunt of them all was one by Prasad and Mr. Rajan, who's now head of the Reserve Bank of India, which came out in a final form, first as a working paper, first as a kind of almost Einstein paper that distributed around the IMF, and then as a normal working paper of the IMF, and eventually as a paper in Brookings Papers of Economic Activity, where with quite some refined econometric work, they reached the conclusion that it is negative for growth. That opening up your capital account, depending on capital inflows, is negative for growth. Professor Eisenman also did a few things at that time, for instance, showing that countries that self-finance their growth have grown much faster than countries that depended on foreign finance. So first point is, because in the literature about debt restructuring, I see a lot of people being quite doubtful about measures being taken that could somehow result in less access to the international financial market for the indebted countries or whatnot. And that could be a negative thing, and that should deter us from taking some measures about what we to do with debt. If that literature was right, which I think it is, then we shouldn't mind that much. To the contrary, as I would say almost immediately at the end, good. If we are cut off from the international financial market. At some time, very provocatively, in a public meeting in Argentina, I said, I'm so grateful to Judge Green. it has completely excluded us from international financial. Well, it's a very controversial view. There's also quite interesting, at the beginning when we were invited to this meeting, Helen Rey was supposed to be the moderator of this panel, and I remember that Helen Rey produced a fantastically good paper last year at the Jackson Hole meeting on the Santa San Forum of Central Bankers in Dilemma and Not Trilemma, in which she shows that also the idea that with floating exchange rates you can have monetary policy independence, it's not a valid idea. And that if you have free capital flows, you don't have any control on your monetary policy. So that for having independence in monetary policy, you should somehow put sand in the wheels, to use the old expression about what to do with the Tobin tax or things like that. The second major point I want to make is about that we should be very, very clear about distinguishing private versus public interest, both in the process of debt accumulation and then in debt restructurings. I mean, one thing is the relationship between creditor and debtor. It's an individual relation. And as I said 2 years ago in Berlin at the INET meeting, one should be very clear that as when one has debt, one has a credit. I mean, there's always a creditor on the other side. And so that is a typical relation which is governed by profit, risk, whatever, and the convenience for the debtor to get into debt. And it has a totally different logic. Now, once a accumulation of this kind of individual cross-border relations accumulate, then we start seeing a economy-wide thing. And then we start speaking about debtor countries and creditor countries, which I think is very misleading because, I mean, workers in Germany, I don't think, particularly involved in having invested in Greek debt, for instance, or workers in the United States wouldn't also be investing in Latin American debt in the 1970s. So, but this build-up of links between individual creditors and debtors, sometimes the debtor is a sovereign, is a government, then dominates the whole thing. Now, the relationship between each debtor and each creditor is a zero-sum game. I mean, there's basic opposition. I mean, what the debtor doesn't pay, the creditor doesn't get. And so the conflict is very obvious, although both creditor and debtor might take a more kind of wide view, and the creditor might accept some reduction or postponement in getting his due for the sake of preserving a good business relation, and the debtor also might force himself, herself, or whatever to pay very continuously a debt for the sake of preserving a good relations. Now, in the case of now economy-wide relations, when a whole set of these individual debt contracts accumulate, now you have a different thing. The whole economy is influenced by this accumulation of debt or credit contracts, and then public interest becomes involved. In fact, in domestic situations also, we know that then governments might get involved. I mean, you don't allow Chrysler to go bust, or you didn't at some point, and various other firms. I mean, even if in a domestic thing, not in a cross-border situation, there are the courts, and then there are procedures for the creditor to get his what he claims to be his rights, still there, when the is now how the governments interpret that public interest. It might well happen that governments of the countries of residence of creditors, I mean, it's not creditor countries, it's countries in which creditors reside, banks, funds, whatever. It might be that the government of that country interprets public interest as the narrowest defense in of the gain of the creditor of collecting its funds. And a mirror image of that could be the case of governments in the countries of residence of debtors, of themselves being one of the major debtors, the government itself, to go to any draconian extreme so as to honor the direct or indirect obligations. This is almost a parody, but it was what has happened for a long, long time in this matter. I mean, the public interest of the respective countries has been interpreted in this extremely very narrow sense by the authorities. Now, the matter is that when you try to understand what the debt repayments or a debt restructuring might do to the countries at large, the countries of residence of creditors and the countries of residence of debtors, things are not that clear. I mean, my point, the point I already made in the 1980s when I was pretty involved in debt renegotiations at that time, was not necessarily there is a conflict of interest between countries of residence of creditors and countries of residence of debtors. And for instance, one thing that showed that very patently was back in 1988, in an appendix to the World Economic Outlook that was distributed during the interim committee meetings of March 88, the Research Department of IMF produced a simulation with a multi-mod model about what would have happened had the advanced countries finance over a period of 5 years half of the debt service of the indebted countries of that time by issuing and financing that by issuing debt in the domestic markets. And the result was a boom in world economy, a boom not only in indebted countries, but also a boom of the advanced countries. The Department of Commerce of the United States had come up also with estimates of how many jobs because of the loss of exports, because of countries devoting the scarce foreign exchange to pay debt service and not to buy things, how many jobs were being lost in the United States because of the debt crisis and the way in which it had been interpreted by governments. Governments like the one of the United States and governments like that of Great Britain at that time that took the side of the narrowest possible interpretation of the public interest. Let's make sure that the banks, yes, I'm coming to conclusions. Let's make sure that that the banks get all the money they have the right. So, conclusions, very brief ones. Adam Smith already advanced a little bit my own point of view. Conclusions. On the matter of prevention, so to speak, and on the matter of what to do during the boom years, well, I think one has to reach for a wholesale system of administration of capital flows, but not only from the countries that receive the capital inflows, like Chile did, or like Argentina has been doing, and many other countries, Brazil did, place at some points taxes on some capital inflows, etc., but also on the countries of origin of those funds. In the case of Europe, for me, it's very clear, I also having been the experience of a central banker, how come the supervision of French or German banks didn't realize that lending to Greece was not a safe thing at all? And why didn't under Pillar 2 or Basel 2 stop them? I mean, above any other consideration. But they could say, look, no, you don't lend any more to Greece, because that's, and so the story is totally different. No, it's the irresponsible Greeks that accumulated the debt. And what about the lenders to Greece? Were they very responsible? What about the supervisors of the lenders to Greece? Anyway, first thing, we have to reach an agreement about that. I mean, lending to emerging market countries is an asset, it's an asset class. And it should be also a matter of stopping that asset class bubbles. And that is a responsibility also of the supervisors of the banking system and of other financial institutions in the originating countries. So that's a wholesale story that we have to go. And there's very little in reports we heard yesterday, a panel about Basel and all those reforms. There's very little in those reforms about stopping that kind of asset bubble. In the moment of bust, then we should do a different, totally different thing also. Accept that maybe Adam Smith was right.
Okay, thank you very much, Domenico, and thank you to CG and Ida for the opportunity to talk with you about sovereign debt restructuring, which today I want to convince you is the most important issue and hole in the international financial sector that we need to plug. And secondly, leave all of you feeling like activists to go out and plug it, because I think we can design what is more or less a very pragmatic and practical program to improve on the status quo. And I want to outline for you some of the broad contours of that program. First of all, though, I think it makes sense to look backwards 2 years to the first INET-CG conference, which posed the question, are current institutions and procedures for resolving sovereign debt crises adequate for the challenges that lie ahead? And at that time, much like the discussion on financial regulation post-Lehman, the resounding answer from both CG, INET, and others gathered was in a word, no. And so that could leave us feeling rather depressed, because you may have the sense that in the course of crisis management, we haven't done much to deal with sovereign debt restructuring over the longer term. But in fact, we have had a few meaningful reforms in the last 2 years since INET and CG met in Waterloo. Inside Europe, particularly, we've had the creation in September 2012 of the European Stability Mechanism, essentially an IMF for Europe. And in 2012, Eurozone countries agreed to include collective action clauses, essentially provisions that allow a majority of bondholders to agree to a restructuring and impose those terms on any holdouts or non-participating creditors that dissent in all sovereign debt issued in Europe from 2013 onward. We've also had a reopening of the discussion on sovereign debt restructuring at the IMF with their board paper in April of 2013, and it's hoped we're going to see another follow-up on that paper in June of this year, though I'd encourage you to watch this space. I think that's going to keep evolving. We've also had some sense, as you know, that the crisis is easing, particularly in Europe. Peripheral yields have come down below 4% at the 10-year part of the curve. Ireland and Portugal have both returned to medium long-term debt markets, and Greece is following them. So you could say that in some ways, my interest in sovereign debt restructuring is becoming less relevant rather than more so. But I'd like to convince you today that, in fact, it's never been more relevant to be speaking about how we deal with debts that can't be paid by sovereigns. First off, just a few weeks ago, the BIS issued a wonderful version of its quarterly report that gave a really great accounting of what's happening with sovereign debt and debt more broadly from both private and public creditors. And to note that the total market of debt securities in the world has now grown to $100 trillion as of end of 2013. That's up 40%, as you can see in the left-hand graph here, from 2007. Two-thirds of that increase is as a result of stimulus-driven borrowing in order to contain the financial crisis and the recession. We've also seen, for the third time in the last 100 years, advanced country debt-to-GDP ratios spike by 30 percentage points of GDP in a very short period of time. If you look to the left on the red line here, you can see that both of the previous two jumps were at times of essentially war-related spending, and the growth spurt that came after it provided an opportunity to bring those debt-to-GDP ratios down very quickly. Now, it was said in the previous plenary one shouldn't front-run Larry Summers, but I don't wish to do that, but I do wish to perhaps provide him some runway to run on. And that's to say that if you buy the notion of secular stagnation, which I do, then we're very unlikely to see this debt-to-GDP burden brought down quickly at any point in the next few years. And I think this ties into a broader problem in our crisis management that has long-term implications. The fact is we've been terrible at calling the end of this crisis and this recession. And if you want a great instantiation of that, try Googling end of crisis and then put in the year 2009, 2010, 2011, 2012, and 2013. You will get thousands of hits up for each of those years. On the one hand, I think that's wholly understandable. No one likes being in a crisis, and in fact, I have the sense that most of us are rather bored of it. But by detaching ourselves from the reality highlighted by Rogoff and Reinhardt, and focusing rather too much on the errors in their spreadsheet, we've really forgotten to keep in mind the big insight from some of their work, which is that a financial crisis takes at least 8 years on average to unwind. On average, many take longer than that. So to think that we would have escaped the crisis in 2009 or 10 was folly. To think that we're free of it now in a way that's going to bring debt to GDP ratios down quickly is, I guess, the definition of insanity, doing the same thing and expecting a different result. Secular stagnation is not just about short-term prospects for recovery. It's about long-term debt sustainability and the extent to which we can put finances on a reasonable footing over the medium term. And in this context, I do want to say that Canada has been seen as a leader in fiscal probity, but I think it's actually committed a big mistake in leadership in the financial system. When the G20 gathered here in 2010, the hallmark of Canadian engagement, and I speak as a Canadian on this front, was a focus on medium-term fiscal targets and a rush to get Canada itself to balance this year. Those, I would argue, were both the wrong targets. When we're faced with secular stagnation, with already high debt burdens, I think one can argue that, in fact, we may need to borrow our way out of the debt burdens, as I think Larry Summers will highlight tomorrow night, and as he did at the Council for Canadian Council for International Relations on Thursday. As monetary and fiscal stimulus go into retreat, household savings is rebounding, and central banks are accumulating reserves, we're seeing a broad tightening of financial conditions. And certainly in the Eurozone, as Domenico alluded to, as inflation comes in lower than anticipated, that too is a tightening, because that means that realized real interest rates are higher than was anticipated at the time of borrowing or at the time of making investment decisions. Aging populations thrown into the mix ensures that employment to population ratios, which are already at 40-year lows, are going to go lower, and entitlement-related spending is going to go higher. So that even though, as some have argued in the FT recently, with interest rates at very low levels, we are unlikely to see growth being high enough to stabilize debt ratios. In fact, we might see something much worse. With low interest rates, we see asset bubbles forming again and again. And if we take the research from Berg and Austerity from the IMF seriously, that encourages inequality, and that is negative for growth. Now, I look to Greece here, and I keep it in mind because that's certainly the scenario that I think we see forming for not just another peripheral in Europe, but for the advanced industrialized countries as a whole. And again, I'm taking IMF and OECD projections here, and and putting them into the standard IMF debt sustainability framework. And when you do, it's pretty hard to suppose that the debt to GDP burden is going to come down anytime soon. Based on IMF forecasts from the WIO, we expect to see nominal GDP growth running only about 0.5 to 1 percentage point ahead of effective interest rates over the next 5 to 8 years. If primary balances were at zero, we would see debt to GDP ratios coming down. But they're not projected to be at zero. They're projected to be at about 3.5 percentage points of GDP. Add into that the aging populations, which I noted earlier, which the OECD and the IMF anticipate will increase public health and long-term care expenditure by 3.5 to 7 percentage points of GDP, and add in additional pension spending of about 2 percentage points of GDP, and you see fiscal pictures eroding by 5 to 10 percentage points of GDP across industrialized countries. Now, this is not just a notion about looking far off. It's actually an immediate term and issue for many places. We've seen some sovereigns like Puerto Rico and some American cities get into trouble. We know that some small island states and Caribbean countries in the Pacific as well have debt to GDP ratios that can't be restructured under existing conventional measures. And of course, there's the taper tantrum that is occurring in emerging markets. One of the things that the IMF has highlighted is that the problem with debt restructuring is not that we get too much too soon, but too little too late. Generally, countries have a pathology that affects them, that causes them to delay debt restructuring rather than moving it forward. And here I would say that there are three sets of issues we need to address in improving international financial architecture on sovereign debt restructuring. We need to bring down the cost ex ante, that is before a crisis of entering into a restructuring process. We need to deal with the need for a standstill mechanism to assess problems in the midst of a crisis. And we need to bring down the cost of completing a debt restructuring ex post. And here, Argentina is incredibly relevant with the two cases that throw pari passu and payment systems into doubt in the United States court system. And indeed, throw all previous debt restructurings into the possibility of being reopened. I want to propose, and what CG and I have been working on for most of the last 6 months, is the idea of a sovereign debt forum, which is committed to addressing these ex-ante costs. No other proposal coming forward right now is focused on doing that. And we see this as complementary to the work that the Bank of England and the Bank of Canada have done on contingent debt. That is, debt whose service comes down when conditions in countries are poor, and the work that many are doing in informal and legal sectors to improve the collective action clauses to make them more effective. We're still a long way from getting agreement on that, but we are close. But it's worth keeping in mind that the collective action clauses in the Greek debt exchange failed more than they succeeded, so we do need refinements there. But this is CG's addition to the menu. We need to deal with ex ante, immediate arrest, ex post costs. The Sovereign Debt Forum is meant to ensure that we continue to do research on this area on an ongoing basis, and we provide a proactive venue for creditors and debtors to come together to deal with debt problems when the options for resolving them are the greatest, rather than later in the game when we are more cornered and the options for preserving value are rather limited. Essentially, it's an argument for using soft power and soft institutions. This would be something that is created on a consensual basis without an underlying treaty and without an international institution in the sense of the IMF and World Bank being created with agreed articles underpinning it. There's a lot of precedent for this sort of thing. The Paris Club, which has done over 450 debt exchanges, provides a great example of something like a sovereign debt forum that has worked effectively without any legal underpinnings. The Extractive Industries Initiative, APEC, GATT, CGAP, even the World Economic Forum at Davos are institutions that work in this way. As I mentioned, what it would do is essentially bring stakeholder consultation earlier into the crisis resolution game, and it would provide the missing mix that I see in the reform agenda that we need to undertake going forward. It's pragmatic, it's doable, it doesn't put a this back into the scenario of negotiating a sovereign debt restructuring mechanism, as was rejected in 2003, but can incrementally improve the world in a meaningful way. So thank you for your consideration, and I hope you become evangelists.
So far, all we've really done is shift it around. We know how to shift it from the private sector to the public sector, or from the public sector back to the private sector, but we don't know how to get rid of it. There are two ways to get rid of it, one of which is restructuring. If you do restructuring, you reduce the amount of net financial assets held by the private sector, but you do it specifically. Some individuals take a loss. If you do it by monetization, you say you no longer hold this government bond, what you hold is money. Net financial assets are unchanged, but you now hold money. From the moral hazard things that Professor Hege pointed about, you know, the danger that a sovereign believes in future it can borrow as much as it wants, you've thought these are equal. So shouldn't these be simply things that we now empirically debate, which are the most appropriate at this particular point in time? Because both of them breach the idea that somebody has got to pay back the debts which they have incurred. Are there some circumstances, Professor Hege in particular, in Europe, where we shouldn't be doing restructuring, but we should just be doing straight monetization?
Thank you. Question, lady on the third row.
My name is Anne Keshkoff from Prime Economics. I want to wish Brett House all the very best in his soft institution. We tried very hard in 2001 to set up a framework for the resolution of sovereign debt crises, but we had the backing of the IMF for a while, but we were massively subverted by, in particular, earlier management. I think they call themselves now in New York. And I somehow, I mean, much as I would like to see it succeed, I just simply cannot believe that you can manage contractual relationships between debtors and creditors in this soft kind of let's be kind to each other sort of framework. It hasn't worked in the past. And I don't see how it can work in the future. And I would really encourage you to be a bit tougher, because we really need to persuade creditors that they need to face the discipline of market forces and not just simply benefit from the gain.
Thank you. Let's go to some more questions. Question, lady on the second row.
Yes, Katharina, you say you from the University of Copenhagen. I would just like to question the problem of the free capital movements, because I think if you look from, if you check the look at the data from, say, beginning or middle of 80s, you can see that was more or less when most restrictions on capital movements were lifted in the world. And you can see an enormous increase in credit and in credit finance consumption. And I think together this caused all the problems we have. And the question is whether can we continue to have the same, and I really question the ability of us to maintain the capital movements, because in a sense we are facing so many problems in the future of global warming and this say consumption credit, the consumption driven credit is clearly something that threatens some of our policy. In the future, we also have the limited natural resources and so on. So I think, in a sense, there is this very fundamental question: how can we design a system so that we do not get into this kind of dilemma once more?
I have two questions on the back. The lady and then the gentleman.
Oh, nobody has mentioned Draghi's cash and trash program. And I would like to know, to what extent has...
Can you raise your voice?
Draghi's cash for trash program. We know that European banks, which have shaky balance sheets, were encouraged to hold sovereign debt because they didn't have to reserve against it, right? don't need to, but the practice has been to prop up these banks with that cash and trash program. And so, you know, what if they took their Club Med debt and sent it to their own central banks and back to the European Central Bank, and then the European Central Bank canceled that as a way, a sort of a selective reduction of debt for that set of holders? Because, we, you know, with the last speaker, you know, we can't have the Paris Club anymore because we can't find the holders. We can't find the hedge funds in the individual sense with the Mexico.
Thank you.
My question addresses this very last point and how to head off future crises. Keynes wrote at various times, there should be a registry of cross-border debt at the Treasury or the Ministry of Finance. The United States, for example, under its tax laws, Form 8938, requires you to report any foreign bank account worth more than $10,000. It would be easy enough to expand the registration to any foreign debt claim greater than $10,000. And you cannot deny that the U.S. Treasury has now, thanks to that form, a list of everybody who has a foreign bank account. Why is it so impossible in the world of international finance to say that you are no longer a member in good standing of the G10, for example, unless your Ministry of Finance enforces a cross-border debt registration starting at $10,000. And then you'd have the list, and the bank examiners would know, and everything else.
Thank you.
Any other question? Right. So let me call the panelists in reverse order. Any Brent, do you want to start?
I'll pick up some of the questions. First, on the discussion between monetizing in a way or restructuring, we're not being very effective at creating inflation, so the extent that we can actually monetize it, at least at this point, is maybe a bit moot. If we start seeing greater effectiveness at generating inflation, I think that's the point where we can have a meaningful discussion.
You can always monetize it. Any central bank just buys it, it monetizes it.
It could do, or you know, even more gently to its balance sheet, you know, you simply inflate it away. You know, and depending on the central bank and the legal framework, that's certainly a much easier thing to do. Yeah, on the question of can we do soft institutions or informal institutions like the SDF, you know, the concerns and the experience that we pointed to, I think, are incredibly relevant. There are also precedents, though. I mean, there's the American Bankruptcy Institute, there's INSOL, that works in a very similar way to improve the system and to facilitate deals in the corporate sector. And I think we're trying to learn lessons from those. My co-author was instrumental in setting those up. And I think they offer a lot of insight. I think in political economy terms, putting this forward, you know, we're actually going to the private sector at a very proactive stage. So I'm sure you did too, but you know, we want to ensure that they're invested stakeholders in this, and you know, I would like to learn lessons from your experience. I'm sure there are many. On the issue of you know, can you find out actually who is involved or who holds the debt? Under the Financial Stability Board's indicator, unique identifier system that they're implementing, they're essentially doing the registry in many ways that you're calling for. As it is, it's actually already pretty easy to find out who the big debt holders are whenever a country gets into crisis. I mean, that's on Bloomberg most of the time. You know, for instance, on the Ukraine right now, a third of their foreign debt is held by Franklin Templeton. So, you know, do you get every single bond identified as location? Probably not, but you can get the bulk of it pretty quickly, usually.
Thank you.
Sure.
I don't think one has to take either or kind of solutions. I mean, for instance, the way in which part of the deal in the United States in the 1980s and now in Europe is forbearance. I mean, the central bank or the supervisor of the system is turning away from really saying how much of the assets of the banks are actually performing. Now we are kind of very sorry. exercise of the qualitative assessment of assets, and there would be, you know, kind of the ECB would be in charge of that. I'm sure there would be again a political cat of market about it all. I mean, we all have a presumption that many European banks don't have enough capital. And then turning the eye, I mean, their lending to some of these periphery countries could be kept in the accounts at the kind of nominal value. As they did in the United States between 1982 and 1987 or 88, 89, when 87 for the first time, Citibank said, well, I'm quite ready to sell part of my assets in the secondary market, because they had accumulated enough revenues and enough provisions to be able to accept the loss. So I think this might take much longer in the case of Europe, no doubt, because banks are enormous. I always remember a global financial stability report of about a couple of years ago. It showed that lending by banks in the center countries of Europe to the periphery, the sum total of that was 22 or 24% of the GDP of the center countries. So that was never the case in the case of the United States. That's an enormous sum, and it's much more difficult to digest. But anyway, I think forbearance, some monetary kind of absorption. I mean, there's this padre, the father in Spanish, proposal by Paris and Biklos, which would be for the ECB to kind of buy this debt and immediately transform them in perpetuities at no interest rate. And that could be one solution, why not? I mean, that is possible. So I think one should try bigger things, forbearance, actual taking up of losses at various points, this kind of monetizing. I mean, I think there are many, many different solutions. One point I want to stress is that this is something that governments have to take up. It's not the question that the creditors could bargain for. I mean, if there was something that was wrong in the 1980s, and I talked with this with the bankers, that they were there that were negotiating with us, the debtors. Obviously, what they wanted is to collect the money. And so they were not the right side to bargain for this. While at the same time, governments had a different, could have a different idea. So this is a question about government, it's a public interest, government intervention, and governments have to intervene to take up these issues.
Okay, thank you. Ulrich?
Thank you. I would like to pick up two questions. First, Adler Turner's question about debt monetization. I agree, this is the intellectual debate of the day, monetization versus restructuring. It's actually forced upon us because monetization is so attractive. I would say monetization is underway, right? Quantitative easing is monetization, OMT is monetization. I would say, what's the problem with monetization? It's attractive, certainly. It produces a lot of collateral damage, right? It is untargeted. It is unreliable, and it will not be permanent. You can count it permanent, right? If you buy back the debt at face value at some point, you know, actual equilibrium will tell us there will be damage to the value of the currency. If you buy it at market value, for how long do you wait? So I personally think monetization has those downsides, unreliable, untargeted, not permanent. The other question I would pick up is cash for trash in Europe. Actually, the banks did not sell on that much sovereign debts to the central bank as they could have. Right, the central bank was posting the ultra, the long-term debt facility, that the banks basically reimbursed early. The depressing news is they found even trashier debt to sell to the central bank than the sovereign debt. The sovereign debt had actually two attractions to keep on the balance sheet for the banks. First, zero risk rates, what beats that, right? And second, it's actually a very convenient political hostage. Because, I mean, what has happened, you can look this up in the recent IMF report on Europe, what has happened is the nationalization of the sovereign debt holdings of the banks. It's now only the, more or less, only the Italian banks holding the Italian debt and so on. So the policymakers are completely captured by their banks, saying if you dare restructuring, we are all dead.
Yeah, well, on the issue between monetization and debt restructuring, well, it's always better to have a restructuring than monetization because, as was said, it's more targeted. But depend, if you're going to monetize and that doesn't have an impact on inflation, that would just keep your interest rates down, which is somehow what's already happening now. And I think accelerating inflation is very, well, from Latin American experiences, it's too dangerous to be a viable solution. I insist that growing away from your debt is a solution that's on the table. It always strikes me in this European discussion how that is not usually emphasized enough, maybe because Europe is already a high-income region with low income inequality, so accelerating growth may create other problems than just so that are greater than solving debt, maybe attracting more immigrants to Europe. I believe the sense that we see from the rest of the world, seeing the European regions, that they're Europeans some way or another satisfying with the growth rates or the dynamics that you see nowadays. So that's why recovery is not really one of the best options or the main option to solve the crisis. Without that, you eventually will have some restructuring. And it will be a European problem will be solved amongst Europeans and whoever is going to get the haircut from that. Obviously, there is another way of that, is accelerating growth, but to have that, you have to have the borrower and the spender of last resort, which is in this current situation when you have negative or zero real interest rates, is really when it's logical, even from a financial perspective, to borrow and spend. And that's, I think, the best way to solve this. And restructuring, I think, is the last resort.
Thank you. Yes, I'm the real economic guy in this panel, and I will suffer, want to object against what Mary Summers will repeat tomorrow, that there will be a secular stagnation period. Nothing can be more wrong than this. All the forecasts are telling us that GDP growth will be 3 percentage points per year in the next 20 to 40 years, and even there's technology available to support this growth, and 2% means doubling incomes in 25 years. The problem is, the question is whether Europe will take part on this growth path and to which it's named, and whether the United States will take part. And for this problem, specifically Europe, it's important that we have some sort of restructuring. And I'm very supportive of all the proposals which I made here today, ex ante restructuring, ex ante rules for government, government bankruptcy, and also on the positive side for Europeans, the European states can issue government bills jointly. The problem is with this growth path, basically it will increase welfare, and to which degree the slow growth in Europe, which we expect, and the high growth in the world, which we expect, will increase welfare. And that means we have to look at the structure of the taxes, whether financial assets and speculation is taxed, or whether labor is taxed. And on the expenditure side of government, whether government expenditures are used for gender equality, good schools, education, and innovation, or whether it's used for more bureaucracy.
opportunities that the world economic growth is about 3%, and we are shaping our systems by shifting income distribution, by shifting government expenditures, and by shifting taxes. I think it can be a welfare increasing path to which we come, and we shift innovation that is going for social needs, for health. But we will expect life expectancy will be 100 years for those which are born today, so that is not of investment into health and lifestyles, which is possible here. So I'm very optimistic, but we have to change our system, and the financial sector will help. We'll hopefully be more resilient than in the past crisis proposals, which were made by Ulrich and by Brett. But then we need to work on the real economy, on innovation, education. A lot is to be done here.
Thank you, Karl.